has similar dimensions, you know.
Oh, that's what we were missing.
So in the parallel.
We did. We don't assume sigma dimension zero.
Right.
So we don't have that. My question is no. Answer no. We have differential transcendence bases in the coordinate ring.
Yeah,
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I see.
Is this just a characteristic zero theorem, or is it true in characteristic?
It's in any characteristic.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. And so the basic idea of the proof is that you show that the limit degree is one if and only if the coordinate ring is finitely generated as a K-algebra.
What does that say about defining some kind of linear relation?
Yeah, that's
what it is. Yeah, that really limits.
So maybe the idea is like so if the limit degree is one at some point, you stabilize. So the limit degree being one means that these projections we had, this pi I, are isomorphisms.
Right.
So from some step onwards, nothing is happening anymore. So, so you're done.
Yeah.
And so that's. Okay, so now this is the last part. And this is about the very special class of different algebraic groups, which are called sigma et al. And the main result here is some decomposition theorem for these groups. Okay, but I'll start with the definition of sigma et al. So a different algebraic group is called sigma et al. If the coordinate ring is a union of et al. Algebras, and another way to say this is that every element of the coordinate ring satisfies a separable polynomial over the base field. Okay. Let's see some examples. So if you take the roots of unity, then this is et al. This is sigma et al. If and only if the characteristic of the base field does not divide n. Okay, so you have to work a little bit to see this maybe, but maybe we can do this in the afternoon.
Yeah.
And so in a more general example is that if you take any et al. Algebraic group, then if you think of it as a difference algebraic group, then this difference algebraic group is sigma et al. So the first example is a special case of the second example. And okay, another example would be this here. So we take the nth root of unity such that sigma of g equals 1. This is again sigma et al. If the characteristic does not divide n. And maybe the last example, you can take any finite group with any endomorphism. And so if you have a finite group, you can think of it as an algebraic group. And to an algebraic group, there corresponds a Hopf algebra. Okay, so let's take this Hopf algebra. This is what we do here. So it is just a direct product of copies of K. And to define a K sigma algebra structure, we only have to say how sigma is acting here. And we define the action of sigma with this formula. So here we do have a canonical basis, call it EG. And then we define sigma by summing over all the inverse images of G under sigma. Okay, you can check that this defines a K sigma Hopf algebra, structure, and then so clearly this algebra is et al. Okay, so this the corresponding difference algebraic group is sigma et al.
So this is going to be transcendence to be zero. It's going to be algebraic.
Yes. Precisely. This is, mm-hmm. Yeah, this yes. is precisely this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So in some sense, sigma et al. Difference algebraic groups are kind of the smallest difference algebraic groups you can come up with. Yeah, they have dimension zero. So dimension in the usual sense, in the classical sense, they have dimension zero. And so why are these sigma dal sigma algebraic groups important? So well, on the one hand, they're nice categories, so subgroups and quotients of sigma dal algebraic groups are again sigma dal. And also they occur naturally. So really what we want to do is we want to understand a general difference algebraic group G. And so like for algebraic groups, there's a notion of a connected component. And so any difference algebraic group fits into such an exact sequence where the connected component is, okay, it's connected. So one way to say that it's connected is to say that the spectrum of the coordinate ring is connected. And the quotient then is sigma eta. Okay, so in this sense, to understand a general difference algebraic group, you understand sigma eta sigma algebraic groups, and you have to understand connected difference algebraic groups. But so this sigma eta, so maybe if you think about differential algebraic groups, it's really kind of different here. So for differential algebraic groups, like for algebraic groups, this is always finite. So basically, this is just a finite group. But here, in the difference case, we can have infinitely many components. So also these quotients are in some sense infinite.
Catching up. The E sub picture are the listing of all the elements of G.
So the E sub, these are the canonical basis of this vector space.
How can you have infinite, you mean infinitely many usual components?
Infinitely many usual components. Infinitely many minimal prime ideals in the coordinate ring.
Can you comment how it's related to your theorem with finitely many difference primordials?
One can show that in a finitely sigma-generated K-sigma-Hopf algebra, there are only finitely many minimal prime ideals which are sigma ideals. But there might be infinitely many minimal prime ideals.
Backtracking question back to the connection with Kowalski and Philae. Do they really work with arbitrary algebraic groups, or do they require reduced irreducible?
They do summations.
What is the actual connection? Then theirs in the affine case is equivalent to yours in the irreducible case.
Yeah. So I mean, if you change
their definition to allow reducible things, then it's a reducible.
Yeah, if you change that definition to allow reducible things, okay. Yeah.
What do you mean by reducible? Yeah. In the topology?
Sure.
You don't mean...
So if you replace variety...
The sort of terrible difference between the group of roots of unity in a field which has finitely many elements and the group defined by x to the n equals 1,
right.
Which may be very large and some horrible thing.
Yes, I see.
So if you redefine what they mean by variety to mean a fine scheme of finite type, then it's correct.
Okay.
Michael?
Yes?
Using the word reduced rather than reducible. Irreducible. Are your sigma algebraic groups reduced?
Like you mean the coordinate ring is reduced?
Non-zero nilpotence.
Yes.
No, they don't have to be.
The
coordinate ring does not have to be reduced.
In characteristic zero?
Yeah, so in characteristic zero, it is automatically reduced. It's a theorem. I think it's from Cartier. It follows something known about Hopf algebras. Any Hopf algebra in characteristic zero is reduced. So in characteristic zero, everything is reduced.
Type. Oh, wait, any?
Any,
any. Any. Yeah. Doesn't have to be finitely generated.
In fact, any Hopf algebra is a union of finitely generated.
Yes, that's right.
Hopf algebra.
Also, it's always reduced.
Yeah, it's always
so the question would come in.
In calculus, it
included groups that weren't associated with Hopf algebras. Whether these general, more general sigma algebraic groups are reduced or not.
Yeah.
Do you know? Is that known?
No, so I've really not been thinking about this more general morphisms. No.
Okay. Because we don't know the answer for differential algebraic groups.
Yeah, but in characteristic zero, of course, so you can have lots of non-reduced...
non-reduced sigma.
Sigma algebraic groups, yes.
Lower
yeah, yeah. And in fact, so also it's...
okay.
So really, I'm also interested in positive characteristic in general. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
For example, if you... For example, triple, so an interesting base field would be a field of positive characteristic with Frobenius endomorphism,
yeah.
For example. Okay, so to understand the general difference algebraic group, we need to understand, on the one hand, connected difference algebraic groups. Okay, there's really still a lot of work to do there, but the sigma et al sigma algebraic groups are quite well understood by now, I would say. And in fact, so this is the main theorem about the sigma et al sigma algebraic groups. This is the decomposition theorem. So it says... that there is a subnormal series, meaning that each group is normal in the preceding one of different algebraic subgroups, so such that... So I will explain these things occurring here in the next slide. So the first thing here is that you have a sigma-connected component. I'll explain what it is. Yeah, so you have these benign groups, and you have something which is called sigma infinitesimal. Okay, so first I'll explain the... Yeah, so let me say, so this... So maybe some of you have heard of Babbitt's decomposition. It's some decomposition theorem for algebraic extensions of difference fields. And this is some... So it's in Cohn's book, sometimes quite classical. And this is some kind of a group theoretic. You can think of this as a group theoretic analog of Babbitt's decomposition. Okay, so let me first explain what is this sigma-connected component, which occurs here. Okay, so we introduced the sigma topology. So whenever you have a difference ring, you also get an induced map on the spectrum, as usual. Huh? And so we say a subset of the spectrum is sigma closed. If it's closed and stable under sigma, it's easy to check that this defines a topology. And so the end also is easy.
Closed means Zariski closed?
Yes, precisely. Mm-hmm. And the closed sets are in bijection with the radical difference ideals. But here we're taking all prime ideals, okay? No, there's no sigma prime ideals. That's the usual spectrum, usual Zariski topology, okay, even if it's not of finite type. We do it. Okay, and then you say, okay, this is sigma connected if it is connected with respect to this topology. Okay, and.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
Sigma is just an endomorphism.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. So I can send everything to zero if I like?
You have to send one to one. It's a ring endomorphism.
It's a ring endomorphism.
Yeah.
But anything else is fine.
So in the case of kx or something like that,
yeah.
I can send x to zero, right?
Yeah, you can do that. That's fine.
So in the spec of that, and what is the reduced thing? How did it end up? How did I take a prime ideal and I send it x to zero? How do I get another prime ideal?
You take the inverse image of the prime ideal. So the inverse image...
Oh, is it inverse?
It's the inverse image.
It's the inverse.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's how you do it. It's going the other way. It's turning, around.
Okay.
Yeah, you're turning the arrows. Yeah, that's the...
Oh, can you go back to the previous slide for a moment?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Ah, no, that's the wrong direction. Yeah, this one. So So I didn't.
So the sigma from spec R to spec R is really sigma inverse.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I didn't want to write it because it kind of looks strange. No, sigma of B equals sigma inverse of B. But yeah, that's what it is.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So in algebraic geometry, you have this algebraic characterization of the spectrum being connected, and it is that you have no non-trivial idempotent elements. And in difference algebraic geometry, we have the following characterization. You don't have any non-trivial periodic idempotent elements. And periodic means constant with respect to some power of sigma. Okay, so the first thing is something classical, well known. I proved the second thing. Okay.
No, I don't know this.
Yeah. It's also equivalent to having having an element that you have a product of sigma powers of it being one.
Product of sigma powers?
Suppose I have an element E such that E sigma of E is equal to 1. Is that going to produce a non-trivial periodic idempotent somehow?
E sigma of E is equal to 1?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if this is going to give. So E is idempotent. You say,
And how does this specialize for groups?
We say something more about
number two
groups. Yeah, but okay. So that's just a general. Okay, I mean maybe you were thinking that sort of like for algebraic groups, connected and irreducible is the same.
Yeah.
And but it's there is no analog. I'm not aware of an analog of this statement in this setting. Okay.
Really?
Not for sigma connected.
Nothing can be said about sigma prime ideals.
No.
Really?
No. So this is really not about. Ideas. So sigma is much trouble in the Galois correspond. It corresponds to the core. Okay. Okay. Algebraic group is if and for example sigma connected. They are not connected. They are sigma connected. Okay, so it means so sigma connected is really something related to sigma.
Under what sigma?
Any sigma?
Any sigma on your base field K.
Wait a minute. If you take sigma to be identity,
yes,
and I take an algebraic group that is not connected, then somewhere there are actual non-trivial idempotents, and since sigma is identities, they are automatically periodic because they are fixed by sigma.
And in fact, sigma is not the identity, so sigma will not be the identity on the coordinate ring
okay.
of because it kind of shifts the.
Wait, why?
So if you know that
you create new variables.
This shifts.
You
send an edge to sigma words.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a statement about sigma algebraic groups defined by polynomial equations.
Sigma polynomial. Oh no,
by just polynomial order zero. Everything is order zero. So he just says that if it's order zero, then it is sigma connected.
Yes, precisely.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Any difference variety defined by, in fact, any difference variety defined by equations of order zero is sigma connected.
Oh.
Yeah, that's what it's saying. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the way to prove it is that you show that these the coordinate ring then doesn't have constants other than those in the base field. Yeah, because, and I think you can almost see it because it shifts. Then nothing can be fixed. So, and there's the sigma connected sigma algebraic subgroup, which corresponds to the sigma connected component of the topological space, which contains the identity, is called the sigma identity component. Okay, so I'm cheating a little bit here, but I'm not telling you. Okay, so and one can show that for a different algebraic group, you only have finitely many sigma-connected components. So this is, that's nice, because so you can have infinitely many components in the sense that you can have infinitely many minimal prime ideals, but, yeah.
Is the sigma-identity component automatically normal?
Yes. Yeah, you have to show that. Yeah.
Is it characteristic? Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, it's even characteristic.
Yeah, okay.
That's... proving that. So it's
okay.
In fact it's characteristic in a very strong sense, and you have to prove this strong sense what it means. So it's kind of, but maybe that's too technical detail. Let's not go into
this.
Afternoon. Yes, let's do it in the afternoon.
I understand when you say identity, you mean the identity of the group.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But what you wrote is not
sigma component.
It concerns the identity, yes.
Not sigma identity component.
Well, no, it's the component of the spec that contains the identity. That's not it.
It's the sigma component.
It corresponds to that.
Okay. That's fine. So it's
if she is really, really close to making G.
I mean, you have all the choices.
Right.
Are difficult. And this is the difficult culture.
Okay.
Grammar.
And so how... So
grammar
the...
The word that has to go to the closest thing, which is the connected component of the span.
Okay, we can argue about grammar in the afternoon. Grammar and lunch.
No, that just throws me off when I was reading that.
Okay,
so what we still need is this notion of sigma infinitesimal to understand the decomposition theorem. Okay, so let me recall. So in algebraic geometry, you have this notion of infinitesimal. You say that an algebraic group is infinitesimal if its R points are just a trivial group for every reduced algebra.
Oh.
So that's only interesting in positive characteristic.
Why is it 1? What does 1 mean here?
The trivial group. 1 is the trivial group.
Oh, this is the absolute group, right?
1 of the ring.
For example, you can take the pth root of unity in characteristic p.
Yeah.
This is the trivial group then for any reduced.
Nice.
So that's okay. And in different algebraic geometry, so we say that the group is sigma infinitesimal if the R points are the trivial group for every K sigma algebra with sigma injective. So in fact, this is really, you can see one, so you can see the classical case as a special case. So if you take sigma to be the Frobenius, then an algebra is reduced if and only if Frobenius is injective. Okay,
yeah.
So this kind of...
Okay.
Explains the injective
theorem.
So these are definitions, right?
These are definitions.
Yes.
Okay, an example. Sigma infinitesimal, different algebraic subgroup of the additive group. So it's clear if you put, if R is sigma reduced, then G has to be 0, which is 1 here, okay? And for example, this group we had before, so this sigma of g equals 1, implies that G is 1 if your R is sigma reduced. Okay. And more generally, there is something which is analogous to the notion of Frobenius kernels. So in positive characteristic for algebra, when you're studying algebraic groups, there's a notion of Frobenius kernel, and you can generalize this to by replacing Frobenius endomorphism with general sigma. And so if you have any difference algebraic group H, you can embed it into some GLN, and then you can look at this difference algebraic subgroup defined here. So you look at all elements from H such that sigma to the power m is the identity. These are sigma infinitesimal sigma algebraic subgroups, and also one can show that these are that these subgroups, they don't depend on the choice of the embedding. So these are, you can give an intrinsic definition of these subgroups also. These are natural sigma infinities. So to any difference algebraic group, you can associate this sequence of sigma infinitesimal difference algebraic sum.
Oh. Is GA of R and GM of R, pardon the grammar, are they both sigma connected?
GM and GA, they are sigma connected. Like any algebraic group is sigma connected.
You said so.
Yeah.
Oh, are all their infinite subgroups connected also?
So all the
infinite subgroups of GM.
So GM, I think for GM you can have various things, but so for GA everything is connected.
So linear groups are connected. Oh, well, yes.
All the different algebraic subgroups.
Linear
of,
sigma.
Yeah, yeah. So they're even connected. So they're
so
in particular
they,
sigma
they
connected.
Don't have to satisfy
but I think in GM you can have interesting things in GM. They
you
need not
the
need
same,
not be sigma
you
connected.
You don't get the same sort of classification as you do for differential algebraic groups.
So
the pullback, no, you don't have any logarithmic derivative.
So for GA, it's
yeah,
pretty
yeah,
much the same,
sure.
But for GM,
yeah,
it's really different.
It's
we
really
have,
different.
So
yeah. Do you have them all classified? Do you know?
Yeah, they are all classified.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
It's in the literature, your literature?
Yeah, I don't know who actually did it first, but I think it follows from the classification of the subgroups of Tori immediately,
okay.
If you look at the Tversky closures.
Right. Tori. Toros. Plural for Toros.
Yeah. I think that comes first, then the Tori next.
Okay.
So, you get all the subgroups of a torus to you have them all classified.
Yeah. So the classification is this. So essentially, this is all equations. You have to do some.
Okay.
You can add more of this type, but
simpler.
This is
a rare case when the difference algebra is simpler.
Well.
Yeah, not always. Yeah.
No
linear equation.
You have more anomalies. benign we need.
Okay, now we're almost done with the sigma infinitesimal. So this is another description. So this is a purely algebraic description of what it means to be sigma infinitesimal. So there's something called the reflexive closure of a difference ideal. So you take you add all inverse images under sigma, and then sigma infinitesimal means that the reflexive closure of the zero ideal defines the trivial group. Okay. So there's an algebraic description of these groups. And this theorem collects the basic properties of this sigma infinitesimal sigma algebraic group. So they are really small, so they have sigma dimension 0 and limit degree 1, and they are automatically sigma connected. This is like an infinitesimal algebraic group is automatically connected.
Okay,
because it just has a point.
Is the converse okay?
This is very special. If the coordinate ring is finite, which usually it is not, so finite as a vector space over the base field, which usually it is not, then there is a converge, and maybe. not the base field. Okay, now the benign thing, which is the last thing we need to understand the main theorem. So benign is just means that it's an dull algebraic group. So a difference algebraic group is called benign if it is an if it is isomorphic to an dull algebraic group interpreted as a difference algebraic group. So the benign things are those which are nothing new, if you want. Yeah. Okay, so now the main theorem again is that you can find a normal series. So for any sigma and tau sigma algebraic group, you have this normal series. So if you so the first thing is you have this connected component. So the first quotient here is finite, and also this because Gn is sigma infinitesimal and sigma et al, you can also show that this is finite. So you have something finite here, and in the middle, all those things are benign.
Do you have an example?
Okay, yes, so then.
When you say it's a sigma algebraic group, what's the action of sigma in the et al algebraic group?
So if you have an et al algebraic group, you can think of it as a sigma algebraic group.
What's the sigma?
Yeah, so it's kind of, yes. So on the base field, sigma can be anything.
Yeah.
Right.
And then if you go from algebraic equations to difference algebraic equations, the sigma does what it does on the variables. It just shifts on the variables. Awesome. You don't have to cook up an some sigma,
no.
it's already kind of there.
So again, you take the same equations and generate the sigma as you.
Yes.
Okay, so that's the...
So somehow all the sigma information gets pushed to the two outsides, and in the middle you have these nice algebraic groups as quotients,
mm-hmm.
and then whatever was keeping them from being et al, together with whatever extra sigma noise you had left is hidden in Gn, and the first step is just a connected component.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. In fact, so the but actually, so the this quotient is so in if you think in terms of the fields, this quotient so by the sigma connected
right.
component is what corresponds to the core. So you might think of this one as being kind of the hard thing.
So you'd be saying that the sigma component is basically built up from benign or tau
mm-hmm.
groups, and then end up with a sigma infinitesimal.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
if you want to prove anything about sigma connected groups, then you only probably just need to do that for algebraic groups and also for the sigma infinite.
Yeah, so sigma et al. If you want to prove something about sigma et al, sigma connected, sigma algebraic groups. Yeah.
So here's a stupid example. Suppose that I start with G being the fixed point of the multiplicative group. So sigma of x equals x.
Where
the
GI is
going to be.
Yeah, let me see. But so I do have an example also coming up.
Oh, sorry.
So we need like this. We need so G needs to be algebraic over the base field. You mean put something nth root of unity or something like.
Because that's what it does. That's actually tau.
So to be a tau, all your generators have to be algebraic over the base.
Yes,
every G is
all the generators, everything.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
sorry, I
just
didn't mention that. Thank you.
That's just so good.
So these are really small. So the sigma et al, sigma algebraic group, are small. They are dimension zero, by dimension is the usual thing. Everything is algebraic.
Everything is
algebraic. So maybe I skip the details about the proof, but we look at the last example. So this is, So this group is sigma et al, G to the power of 4. And at least if 2 does not the characteristic, if 2 does not divide the characteristic, then this is sigma et al. And so one can show that this group is seem connected, but that's actually some work to show this. So even I mean, I've been thinking about this group quite a lot, but I don't really have an intuition what it means to be sigma connected so much.
You have to go to the spec in order to figure it out, is that correct?
Yeah, so actually you can prove some kind of general results about, like, if you have an exact sequence where the first and the last thing is sigma connected, then the thing in the middle is sigma connected, and stuff, you can use stuff like that. You don't really have to look at the spec so much. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then we define this difference algebraic subgroup N. So it's normal. So we define N like this. So it's a normal difference algebraic subgroup, and so it's obviously it's sigma infinitesimal because of this equation. Okay, so I claim now that this is the decomposition. So we just have just as next one. So N is sigma infinitesimal, as is here, but we have to show that the quotient is benign. And so to do this, we show that the quotient is isomorphic to H, where H is this. And so this is the algebraic group of second groups of unity, interpreted as a different algebraic group. And we show that the quotient G mod N is isomorphic to H. Okay, and to do this, we consider this map from G to H, which maps G to sigma of G. And that's okay, because of the definition of G. So in G, we have sigma G squared equals 1. So we are mapping into H. Okay? And in fact, this map is surjective. Where surjective means the dual map is injective, so the map on coordinate rings is injective. And so the kernel, what is the kernel here? The kernel is precisely N. So it's surjective and the kernel is N, and this means that the quotient is really isomorphic to the image. So you do have this difference. So you do have the analogs of the isomorphism theorems here, and so you're really so the quotient is really isomorphic to H, and so it's benign.
In your theorem, how unique is the sequence?
I don't. You can come up with different sequences for the same group, mm-hmm. but
some calculation of the quotients.
Yeah. So I mean, so there's the there's the analog of the. I think it's called the Schreier refinement theorem.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I proved the analog of the Schreier refinement theorem, mm-hmm. but I'm not. It doesn't seem that it gives, at least not in an obvious way, a uniqueness result for these factors. Yeah. I mean. Yeah, for example, I mean, you can have, if this is benign, so if you could be, like, you can add something benign between those two, for example.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you would, I mean, there's not no, not, like, if you think about Schrödinger-Holder, you have to put some,
things in between.
To get uniqueness, you have to put some assumption of simplicity. And so maybe you can, like, try to introduce something about stuff being simple here also, but yeah, I don't know. It's an interesting question.
I suppose I apply your theorem to just an algebraic group, or a sigma tau, or a tau of algebraic group, then I'll get a sequence like that too, right?
So if you apply, yes. If you start with an Etal algebraic group and you think of it as a sigma algebraic group, then you're done with n equals 1. Then you are benign. That's the definition of benign.
So what I'm trying to get at is, well, that's one way.
Mm-hmm.
But as an Etal algebraic group, I might have a different way of doing it.
Yes, for example, I mean, you might have a sequence of Etal algebraic subgroups of your...
Right, and then you build it up by the...
And then you...
By central retention.
Yeah. So...
Are the extremes unique, though? The connected component...
Yeah, so the sigma connected component is unique, yeah.
And the sigma infinitesimal, because it has that criterion.
Yeah, that doesn't. The way you get it from the proof is like you could make it, if you wanted, you could make it even more infinitesimal, that could kind of like blow it up even more. And
sorry,
then,
I just mean that. Why? At least what I was asking was that the most significant thing in the G?
Well, it's degree. I mean, the dimension is zero. Its degree is one, right? And it is what some is one more condition.
Sigma connected.
Sigma connected. Yeah.
No, but there are points.
No, but I think you
injective.
So
does that characterize the GN?
So I think there's nothing like a maximal GN. I don't think. I mean, you can always blow it up even more. I think, like, it's like, you know, if like this subgroups of
like if you have n's groups. Like if you go, you can always increase this M here. So if that's your pool of R G, you can increase the M. It's getting
makes sense.
It's getting much, you know?
The GIs are supposed to be G, right? Yeah. Okay, sure. Okay, so I can stop here if you want. Okay. So by the way, if I may still say so, today's so I've written my habilitation thesis on these groups, and so it's not online yet. But if you're interested in, so everything I've done on different algebraic group is on a really long thesis, and I can make it available to you if you want to.
How
have
many
it.
Pages? 200.
It's less than 200. It's more than 100.
Habilitation.
Yes.
I think it's online.
It's
online.
It's not yet online. Mine.
The PhD.
I just submitted it a few.
PhD.
Yeah. It's not my PhD. No.
How do you get it?
Yeah.